Thank you, Frodo. And I am Raven, and bringing you the first match of the day with Sottl. These are the semi-finals. Pavel versus Jason Joe. I cannot wait.
Yeah, unbelievable stuff. I'm so hyped for this. This has been a year-long process to get down to this point. We are left with just four players at this point. Great mix. China, Korea in the mix, and the two Europeans. I can't wait to find out who's going to come out on top.
Yeah, we got to actually cast Pavel's game yesterday versus Amnesiac, which was very emotional one for everyone, I think. We were getting a bit crazy on the desk ourselves, but we've not really, we didn't get to cast Jason Joe. Right. We did obviously see him a lot last week, and we did see his match yesterday, but what do you think of him as a player?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to point this out because, you know, we as guilty as anyone else, we as much as anyone else have been guilty of getting caught up in the sort of Europe versus America mass hysteria that's been going on, and very quietly, this representative from China as well as Chansu from Korea have been putting together some of the strongest performances. Jason Joe had one moment yesterday where some eagle-eyed Redditors managed to spot that he'd missed lethal, where he just wasn't looking for a damage push whatsoever. But outside of that, he's been the strongest performer that's left in this tournament outside of, I would say, Chansu. And that's amazing. You know, having a third different region, having, you know, Asia come in now and potentially have the world champion of their own, that'll be so huge for the game, so huge for that region. But standing in his way, the Russian comeback kid, Pavel, who's come back from 0-3 not once, but twice in this tournament.
Yeah, and we are going to get straight into game one. Jason Joe on the Zoo versus Pavel on his Rogue. And, you know, as you just mentioned then, Pavel somehow pulled it out the bag versus Amnesiac yesterday, but I'm pretty sure he's going to want to hope that he doesn't have to fall behind in this series and actually, you know, get ahead and stay ahead.
Yeah, I mean, obviously he's shown that he's equipped to do it, but Pavel probably feels like he's due a break at this point. He's due a nice, easy 4-0. He's had to work so much harder than anyone else to get to this point, just in terms of, you know, minutes on camera and games played. But early on, he does have this Malagos Rogue going up against the Zoo. This is quite a greedy build from Pavel, so it does have the potential to get snowballed by a Zoo deck, but he does come into that all-important coin SI play that Zoo is so afraid of. Pretty much all of their two-mana plays are 2/2s these days, so if coin SI is there for the Rogue, such an early tempo swing.
Yeah, and on top of that, he has Backstab and Eviscerate as well to just negate any early pressure. As you said, this Malagos Rogue is, you know, even slower than, for example, Questing Rogue and some other variations, so it's going to be a struggle to get there with cards like, you know, we can just see now, Pavel has two Sinister Strikes at the top of his hand, and they're going to be pretty useless for the moment. More than likely used to cycle with gadgets and later if he, you know, happens to come out for Pavel. But these backstabs just doing work. Councilman on turn three, instant answer, and most importantly, the SI7 agent is still alive to contend anything that's played from Jason Joe next turn.
Yeah, I mean, whenever you queue up against Zoo, you learn that it's Zoo, this is your goal, right? You think at some point I want to clear their board and I want to stick a minion. And at that point, I feel like I'm in control of the game. Pavel has managed to achieve that as early as turn three, and he has a great follow-up now with the Tomb Pillager. The rest of his hand is completely dry, so he's going to need that SI and Tomb Pillager to do a lot of work for him. But he has secured an early board lead, and that's so huge in this matchup.
Yeah, Jason Joe still has some plays though. You know, being Zoo, he's going to have to start tapping pretty soon. But still got a couple of minions to play. But the frustration from him, as we mentioned, is that the SI7 agent just trades straight away with the Direwolf. So Jason Joe effectively just negating the 3-2, swaps it out for Tomb Pillager, and he only has his Alchemist on the board. And again, this follow-up is just not great. He can't deal with the Tomb Pillager.
He can't, and that really just, you know, gives him no incentive to play Darkshire Councilman here, because it's just going to give him a free trade with the Tomb Pillager into one of the highest value minions in his deck. So he is in a really rough spot right now. I think he may even just have to tap here, try and dig for that Abusive Sergeant, dig for a Soulfire. If not, he still has a strong three mana play to make using the Knife Juggler, and now the choice of the Flame Imp or the Possessed Villager.
Yeah, it's an interesting choice as well, because we've seen the Backstab and an SI and an Eviscerate so early. You just got to say that the Flame Imp, you might just need the power on the board at this point. You know, we've seen that Jason Joe struggled to deal with this Tomb Pillager. If an Azure Drake comes out, the Tomb Pillager trades with one of these minions, then well, it's the same issue all over again.
Pavel needs some help, and that is indeed help. Picks up the Barnes. He has one mana spells available to him, so an Auctioneer or a Malagos would have been a nice outcome for him. Just the Edwin, though, one of the weakest pulls off the Barnes, but still, just drawing another minion there was huge for him, because now he's bridging the gap towards his Auctioneer turns. That helps him cycle through his deck a bit longer if he can pick up, you know, Backstab, Preparation, some of that stuff. Hold off for one more turn, maybe, before dropping the Auctioneer. Suddenly, everything coming together for him.
Yeah, it's not looking too bad at all. Pavel did get a Malagos from his Barnes yesterday.
Yep.
But no chance of that because it is in his hand. So no chance at all. The Van Cleef not going to do too much. And finally, Jason Joe is getting on the board at least just a little bit. The Barnes with that full health is going to be great to start trading down these minions. But Jason Joe's starting to stack up that damage with the Power Overwhelming in hand as well. You know, a lot of burst combined with a Doomguard can kind of come out of nowhere here.
Yeah, I mean, now there's a kind of an interesting decision here for Pavel. Without drawing the SI, it looked like pretty clear that he might just get the Gadgetzan on board for a 4-4. He could cycle the coin and the Sinister Strike in the meantime. But having drawn the SI, he has so much more clearing power now that he is just going to go for the SI turn, continue his board dominance. And the longer he can hold off with that Auctioneer from here, the better it gets, the more potential cycle it provides. The closer you get to those preparations in your deck that can really create the absolute chaos with the card. And Jason Joe has just been having to play this game from behind since turn three, which is just not what Zoo is equipped to do.
No, not even close. And you know, when you get this kind of hand or this opening versus Zoo with Rogue, it is very easy to just get ahead and stay ahead. But Pavel is going to have to navigate the few turns, the Auctioneer, as you said, being the key one. And we even saw like Sinister Strike be used before.
Yep.
Just to prop the SI. You don't really care about the damage. It's a spell that isn't the coin that is going to be used to help just clear up some of the board. The Councilman is now finally down from Jason Joe. That is a Van Cleef. Nothing he can quite do with it this turn. I feel like using the spells this turn just blows your Auctioneer, becomes a 6-mana 4-4.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, the Edwin isn't even really that impressive. You make a 6-6 Edwin, which doesn't really even get you, you know, close to a position of threatening lethal, because you know your opponent has minions on the board to make out trades. So I feel like you're going to need a few extra resources to push through this game. The Gadgetzan Auctioneer looks vastly superior in this situation. Pavel agrees, starting off with the coin. Swashburglar picked up will at least fill out his curve here. Also potential for some one mana Warlock spells. Doesn't get it, just cycles out Wilfred. The Sinister Strike, and he Fizzle did bang. Run a little bit dry on his Auctioneer turn there, but still, he's cycled through his deck a bit more, has more options in his hand moving forward. But this might just be the window now for Jason, where if he has a powerful turn, if we see a Doomguard here, Defender of Argus is not bad either. This could be the moment.
Yeah, especially with that Abusive Sergeant and the Worgen on the board. You can very easily just trade the Worgen in and sort of, you know, guard or protect the health of the Councilman, which is going to be super important, because the best thing about the Councilman is the 5 health like, in total. That's
so
such
huge.
An awkward number to deal with outside of, you know, a Shadow Strike.
Yep.
There's nothing that just directly deals with it in like a 1-for-1 card trade. So I wouldn't mind the trade up here.
The Abusive Sergeant here is just so huge, and Abusive being nerfed to a 1-1 and now only being played as a single copy in most people's decks is such a huge impact, because think all the way back to, you know, the turn where it really started going wrong, where there was the Tomb Pillager on the board. He tapped to try and pick up an answer, didn't hit it, just had to play minions. He'd hit an Abusive that turn. He would have had the amazing value trade. This time he picks it up. So Abusive being weakened has been a big hit to Zoo. It's one of the strongest cards in the deck for sure. It's basically good whenever you draw it in its original 2-1 form. Now it's a bit more difficult to use, but Jason picking it up in good time there to be able to make a tempo swing on the board.
Yeah, and you know, Pavel found himself in a similar spot yesterday where he hit the point where he pretty much needed to draw a sap.
Yep.
And you know, he did have the Auctioneer and managed to cycle through to get it, but just the one draw of the Azure Drake was not good enough, as it's pulled the second Swashburglar in. This is a tough one, because Pavel is facing down a hell of a lot of damage. It's if something Zoo can do,
so
it's definitely
close.
Help. with more damage. Demon Wrath not going to be enough for now, as he simply doesn't have the mana to play it, as wow. well as trade with
mana
the drain.
Off. That would have been huge with the spell damage as well. He would have taken care of the Argus and the 2-2 on the board without taking any damage on his face. So he's left Jason now in a position where he's just digging for 3 extra damage, but he doesn't pick it up. The 2 minions will buff the Councilman, which means any additional damage, a Direwolf, an Argus, abusive. Problem is, there's only one abusive in the deck. There's only one Argus in this deck. So he's actually used a lot of his buffing minions already. And now you see him just drawing a little bit dry, but still comfortable looking position from here.
Yeah, so you know, it's definitely worth the trade there being just one off. You know, there's not a lot of difference between one damage and 3 Azu, the main thing being, say, jugglers going to the face.
This Demon Wrath is glorious.
That is pretty nice, actually.
It leaves up the Malkazar. Oh, is Malkazar Zimper Demon? I'm actually not sure. Okay.
It is.
Oh, of course it is, because people started playing Demon Fire because of the 6-1 drop build. Yeah, of course. So it will leave up the Imp, but still, huge clear with the spell damage of the Drake. The Drake will survive it and still be able to make the trade afterwards into the Councilman. So Pavel has a chance here. He can put Jason back on a draw to win the game.
This is so close. Jason Zhou not on a great health total himself. Although he has seen 2 Sinister Strikes and an Eviscerate, so there's probably just not a lot of just direct burn from hand to end the game from Pavel. Pavel's main game plan is to just stabilize and give Jason Zhao as little opportunity as possible to draw into a victory, but Jason Zhao has actually seen no Doomguard so far this game, and that straight up is just 2 cards in the deck that just wins him. This one straight off the bat. Dark Shadow Librarian is the card that's going to draw and effectively sort of cycling in its teammate as a 2-of in the deck. We will see.
Just not good enough in this spot, though. He has all of his Soulfires and all of his Doomguards remaining in the deck. That is 4 outs right off the bat. Imp Gang Boss
he
is
can cycle with this
yet again. But like you said, he cycles the Councilman. Just the Imp again. This is just getting torturous for Jason. That's a Doomguard.
He gets it. He has not seen a single Doomguard all game. It is about time, and he finishes that game up versus Pavel. That was getting pretty close.
Yeah, and remember, Jason is making a habit of drawing those Doomguards at the right time. We saw this yesterday as well. He got the timely Doomguard, followed by the timely Moonfire in the very next game to be able to seal 2 games. And Jason, you can see emotions almost overwhelming him at this point. Head in his hands, just trying to compose himself. But that Doomguard was needed and honestly well-deserved, because all of his power cards were remaining in the deck, the Soulfires and the Doomguards.
Yeah, there was such a high chance for him to end that game in the next turn with the amount of cycle he got as well. But that is only 1-0 for him. He has got a long way to go to potentially close out this set. And we've got game 2 coming up, Charlie.
The Hearthstone World Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
China ranks in as far as the regions in competitive Hearthstone?
Chinese player didn't play a lot of like international tournament. Basically, we play in our region, but we have a lot of talented players and they all play very well. Let's see if we can get a good achievement this year.
What's been the difference overall between the competitive scene in China and the competitive scene in the Americas?
In NA, there are a lot of online tournaments. But in China, we have Golden Series. Every month, you have an open tournament. Then you can travel and make friends and play Hearthstone. I think it's pretty cool.
What initially made you like Control Warrior so much?
Because I like Sho. He's a very famous streamer on Twitch. I watch a lot of his stream and I feel like, yeah, this deck pretty good. And then I want to try it, like just as a fan. That's why I always play Control Warrior. Yeah. Well, thanks to Sho, he has a good metal.
You play on both ladders?
Yeah, both ladder.
What, is there big differences between the Chinese ladder and the America's ladder?
America, they have like more control players. In China, they have a lot of aggressive players. When I go back to China, I feel like Control Warrior is so tough on China because they all like aggressive decks. Always Zoo, always like Shaman, something like that. So you need to change a bit. I think a good player need to like make the change based on the situation, right?
Jason Joe, they're talking about being flexible and actually needing to change it up. And he did exactly that. He is known as a control warrior god there, saying, you know, Sho is his inspiration. But he switched this up. Players could change their deck list between opening week and top eight. And he swapped out his warrior for a dragon warrior, much more aggressive list.
Yeah, and you know, everyone naturally assumed, looking at that, okay, of course, he's coming up against the greedy priest and the greedy paladin in the opening round against Hamster. And yes, that was a huge factor. He didn't want that warrior exposed, but he'd also planned even further forward than that, and he was looking at Pavel as a potential semi-final opponent. And he said, you know what, that greedy Malagos rogue build that Pavel has, that's a problem for my control warrior as well. I'd much rather just have some dragons and just beat up that deck and rush them down before they can get there. So actually, that rogue not picking up a win in the first game is a big deal for Jason's strategic thinking coming into this weekend, because he's potentially trying to target that rogue deck just a little bit.
Yeah, we're going to see the warrior deck from Jason now, as he has locked it in for game two. His dragon warrior is going to be Pavel's druid. And a lot of the time, you know, the dragon warrior's got quite a lot of late game, can take games pretty long as well, especially with this, the curator list. So you're going to play the curator and just draw additional cards a lot of the time to keep the juices flowing. But it can also just rush someone down and punch them in the face pretty quick.
Yeah. And Jason's warrior list here is still playing both copies of Execute, which is going to be helpful against this list from Pavel, which has these extra mid-game taunts with the Dark Arakoas that he's going to have to push through. A lot of beefy minions in this deck, and it's by no means a given that you play two copies of Execute in your Dragon Warrior anymore. When it costs one mana, of course, it was a no-brainer. This thing costs one, it kills anything, it's an insane tempo card. But when it costs two, much trickier decision. A lot of people are going down to a single copy in the deck, or sometimes even zero. Jason choosing to include both, and it's going to potentially pay out for him in this matchup now against the Malagos Druid.
Yeah, he couldn't go full Dragon Warrior. There's still a splash of control in there just using the double executes. Pavel, though, getting off to a relatively quick start. That innovate into the Emperor, although isn't going to get a huge reduction on a huge hand size, but the actual effect on this is just means he can just curve straight into Dark Arakoa next turn.
Yeah, I mean, based on the actual literal size of his hand, that's not a huge Emperor, but that is a huge Emperor because it fixes his curve so nicely here. The execute gets pulled out of the hand. Dark Arakoa comes down. This is Pavel's unique twist on the Malagos Druid, and it's filling out his curve here perfectly.
Yeah, and that 7 health being a real pain for Jason, as he just has nothing, you know, the Corcrum was just one off being able to very cleanly clear up the Arakoa.
I imagine we're going to be seeing this used to cycle. Yes, picks up the swipe, can continue to curve out with the Maya Keeper here. And this is around the time of the game where you actually have to make a decision. Early on in the game, you ramp literally every time. I don't care what anyone else says. Much later in the game, obviously, you take the token. But in this situation, tempo-based matchup, you have a play for next turn anyway with the Arcane Giant or the swipe if you want to take a removal turn. I like the extra 2/2 on the board in this spot.
Yep, completely agree. I think as well, he doesn't have a lot of options to fill out with, so it's not as if the extra mana is going to do anything or even get him to a particular game plan quickly. He doesn't have a game plan at the moment except for just get stuff on the board and start to really pressure Jason Joe down, because just having a swipe, all that's going to do is just leverage like the board even more.
That execute is so big. He doesn't have a great proc for it right now, but look at Pavel's hand. Jason doesn't really have information as to what this hand is. The Wrath was, of course, recently drawn. The swipe was recently drawn off the cycle of the Wrath on a previous turn as well. So he doesn't have too much of a read as to what's going on here, but I don't think he can let that AA hang around. So I think Jason Joe assesses this situation correctly. He just has to answer this threat on board, hope the hand is dry, and he gets rewarded. The hand is dry. Are we going to see a self-cycle on the Wrath here just to try and pick up some pressure? He is going to go for it. Needs to hit some gas here. That's playable because the Moonfire takes it down to 6 and he just drops it down. Pavel with the snap play. 8-8 number 2. Your executes are gone. Pavel's looking comfortable again.
Yeah, this is a serious issue now for Jason. He can put some speed bumps in the way though. Does have the Twilight Guardian that he can play that's just very awkward to deal with a lot of the time. We can see if Pavel really wanted to, if the Twilight Guardian came down, he can just swipe, trade in the 2-1. But he's still running a bit dry.
They are, I mean, they're speed bumps, but they are speed bumps in the way of a bulldozer right now. They're not going to slow this thing down for long. Pavel has the power to push through, and with both executes gone, Jason Joe is going to have to deal with this 8-8 through board tension. He doesn't even have a face out in this situation. He's done 0 damage this game. He can't even start trying to push in the situation. There's just very little route to victory that I can see from Jason Joe, but he does just try and create some board tension, get some face damage in the meantime. Pavel is drawing, you know, a few dead cards here, but still, that single AA on the board might just be enough to carry him.
Yeah, he can still clear up the board here with the Moonfire and the Hero Power as well, and leave the 8-8 to attack face if he really wants to just start piling on that damage. It looks like that is going to be the plan.
Yeah, again, both executes gone, so, you know, this Arcane Giant almost all the time gets to live. There's Ragnaros that can come down on curve this turn. That's a consideration to try and keep your 2-1 alive, but you can't really do that. And then if there's no Rag this turn, then your 8-8 is basically living until Deathwing, which, you know, by that time it's going to have got the job done. There is a Deathwing in Jason Joe's deck, but he needs to find some serious stalling mechanisms to get to that point.
Yeah, there'll be pretty much Curator as an option, which has a great chance of drawing Deathwing as well. So, you know, Curator or exactly Ragnaros would be the key draws for Jason this turn. What is he going to get? That looked like a 10 mana.
It's an Alexstrasza champion, I'm not going to be good enough. That only allows him to get 7 onto the Arcane Giant, but he can at least take care of the 2-1 on the board and armor up to get himself out of range of the 9 that Pavel can do with the Giant and the Hero Power next turn.
Any form of damage, more or less, is going to take him out, though, and it's such a scary moment.
He's used a lot of it, though.
There's two Feral Rages still left.
Right, he's used 2 Moonfires. He used a Roots early. We've seen Swipe used as well, but the Feral Rages are in there. The Yogg is in there. The Ragnaros is in there. All of these things can make it happen. He does just draw Minion Presence here, so Jason Joe has another chance to get himself out of this, and he has been getting some very timely draws in clutch situations just like this.
Yeah, we'll see. It's only going to be a Frothing Berserker, which is just not going to be enough. This is just going to be game, as he actually just, even if he armors up, Fandral will kill him along with the Hero Power. So Pavel evens this one up with a pretty good win versus the Dragon Warrior there.
Yeah, and one thing we have just learned is Pavel is not going to have to come all the way back from 0-3 this game. He is on the board early, picks up a game win early, and Pavel is looking in much more comfortable spot, but this might be foreign territory for him at this point.
Yep, so don't go anywhere, guys. We are going to be right back with game 3.
Do you think you have a playstyle?
In Hearthstone, it's not about playstyle. It's about which play have better chances to give you a win.
What about if you don't know which play is better?
I will choose play which I feel give me more chance to win.
How did you prepare for the World Championship?
Just thinking about which decks is the best. Test it on ladder and with my practice partners.
Like, who were your main practice partners?
I don't have main practice partners, but I was practice with Yok, Maverick, it's French players. Also, with Naiman and Hippie, we had Skype call.
What's the Russian Hearthstone scene like?
A Russian community have a lot of strong players, for example, Shtanodachi, Unvi, Kalenta, Naiman.
Who would you want to beat the most?
Doesn't matter too much.
Not Dr. Hippie?
Yeah, it will be nice to beat Dr. Hippie. This little troll.
To have a chance at Dr. Hippie, he does have to go through Jason Zhao, though. It is 1-1 at the moment, and then moving on to game three shortly. How do you think this series is going to pan out, Sol, based on, mainly that rogue, to be honest, as you said. The rogue was a tough one for Pavel to get a loss with. Probably really wanted the win just to get it out of the way.
It's true. I have been incredibly impressed with Jason Joe's play throughout this tournament, but I can't bring myself to root against a guy whose cardigan game is so on point as Pavel's is. So, I mean, Pavel's my boy just purely on dress code alone.
Yeah, Sol actually took me out shopping. And took me straight to a store that just pretty much was like, these do the best cardigans. And it was definitely an interesting trip for me. I didn't purchase one myself. I feel like I'm not quite up on that game yet. Okay. But maybe one day you'll get me to wear one.
Yeah, but serious time, the rogue is a big deal. Like I said, Jason Joe had this consideration in his mind. He thought beyond the opening round matchup against Hamster and went all the way through to potentially playing Pavel in the semifinals. And he's adapted his lineup a little bit towards what he was expecting from Pavel in this situation. So I think, Jason Joe, I think, has been playing stronger as well overall. Again, that one miss lethal yesterday where, of course, it's almost unforgivable to miss lethal in a game of Hearthstone, but it was a situation where his opponent was at like 20 something health. He just wasn't looking for a damage push whatsoever, and that one turn aside, he's been playing incredibly strong. So I have to, realistically, cardigan game aside, give the nod to Jason Joe.
Yeah, he is looking fantastic. And I think, again, the main thing, and something we've talked about through opening week and so far yesterday, a bit this morning, is that just consistency and just generally not, you don't need to do anything too flashy, but just not messing up and just playing well overall is actually enough. Something we've seen from Chansu as well, who's also doing pretty well in this tournament.
Yeah, I mean, for a while, Chansu was a guy that I just described as playing robotic Hearthstone, but, this weekend, he's gone even beyond that. He's getting reads into his game. He's outplaying people on the human side as well. So the Asian representatives, Chansu from Korea, and more relevant to this game now, Jason Joe from China, have been incredibly impressive to me. And this has been something that we've long since needed in Hearthstone, honestly, is just a consistent threat coming in from the East just to shake up that Europe versus North America conversation just a little bit. Get them in there. We've had, we've been splitting the world champions a little bit. Firebat followed by Kaka, is it Asia's time in this tournament?
Yeah, it definitely wouldn't surprise me too much based on how these guys have been playing, to be honest. But something we've learned as well is that you can never count Pavel out. No matter what the score looks like, until the whole match is over, it is not finished. He's proven time and time again that he can come back, even in dire circumstances.
Yep, so one game apiece on the board. Both of the shamans are banned out. So
there's the crowd. Shout out to you, crowd. There we go. Some cool signs going on there. Some support for Jason Joe in the crowd as
absolutely.
Well. I saw a couple earlier.
Partizan crowd all rooting for their hope, their favorites, their champions, people from their home region. However they're picking their allegiances, they're getting behind their players. And Pavel is ready to re-queue now. Jason Joe staring at a handful of mana with nothing to play with it. Swipe is not what he needs. He's going to need to pick up some gas here, but he has all the ramp in the world. Pavel is going to have to go and go fast this game to overcome the mana deficit that he's going to have.
Yeah, and taking a note from something we briefly discussed yesterday was that Pavel's mage deck is very minion heavy.
Yes.
Still tempo mage, but with cards along the lines of Water Elemental, double Faceless Summoner. There's just so many minions and like bulky mid-range minions in the deck. Druid kind of just struggles to deal with them most of the time. You know, Water Elemental. How does Druid actually kill it outside of a mulch? Like, not in a very clean way.
Pavo is literally one with Babbling Book. I have never seen a man with such control over Babbling Book as Pavo. Incredible outcomes for him yesterday. Picked up a Polymorph and a Firelands Portal exactly when he needed them. And here, picks up a nice, juicy mirror image to go on curve, buff up his Mana Worm, get the aggression rolling. Everything's looking great for Pavo in this situation because despite all the mana for Jason Joe, as I said, he's just not picking up the plays to go with it.
And look at this already, unless the spell power drawn and maybe a couple more innovates that aren't in the deck. Like, how is this Water Elemental answered? And it's actually going to lock down the hero power potential. That is how it's answered. Good job, Jason Joe. You answered my question pretty quickly there. Mulch can be used, but we said, you know, there's way more mid-range minions in this deck after Water Elemental. So if he has to mulch now, he knows that he's gone from the deck overall. And it means he has to do something pretty brave to keep up later.
He's doing it. I mean, he's going for a full clear here. So I can only imagine from Jason's perspective, he's saying, okay, Pavel, you've drawn a bunch of minions. But you know, in this situation, Tempo Mage is somewhat entitled to run dry. They do play a lot of spells as well. But as you correctly pointed out, so many extra minions in Pavel's deck that he can just constantly keep reloading the gas here. The thing from below obviously isn't going to get huge in this situation or isn't going to get discounted to a huge degree, but it's still just another chunky minion that he can drop on the board at some point. So Pavel's decision to just bring all this extra beef, not just in his mage, but in all his other decks as well, is paying out for him.
Yeah, and you know, you said about the thing from below. We see effigy as well from the Babbling Book.
Sure.
So, you know, there's a chance that Pavel can set up a fortunate situation where the thing from below is forced to get killed because it does have taunt as well. And then that's going to summon, like, resummon a six drop. And there are a couple of powerful six drops in the game. Cairn, Sylvanas being a couple of them as well.
There is one or two of them, yeah, but Pavel does manage to, doesn't manage to find an answer to the Fandral, which means that, say, a Nourish would be a huge draw for Jason Joe, but Harrison picked up, not the matchup that he's aiming this at. Jason Joe does seem to be toeing his lineup towards Control Warrior just a little bit with all his weapon destruction as well as some of his lineup choices, but Harrison is very much a whiff in this matchup.
Yeah, and we see the Sorcerers, the Cult Sorcerers is actually going to line up really well versus the Fandral as well.
Yeah, so Wrath going to come out here, probably to cycle here from Jason. Needs to pick up some gas. That's gas, but it's not playable, but it does give him some game in the upcoming turns to be able to dominate the board. But Pavel here can try and take advantage of this one free turn of tempo that he has available to him to try and create some kind of board state. And this is the situation where you have to take a step back and say, okay, I have massive card advantage. I'm going to have tempo advantage because I'm the first guy playing onto the board. What's the situation that I lose to here? So you have to think about the potential power cards. What could that one card be? It wasn't played with five mana available. Like, literally, what could that card be? Ragnaros is one of the reads, and just by playing the one big minion on the board, Pavel did leave himself a little bit open to that.
Yeah, and we've seen Ragnaros has been very impactful in this tournament overall, and yet again, kills the thing from below, and suddenly Pavel is the step behind. Still has a massive card advantage, but has to deal with this Ragnaros. He cannot just leave it knocking around. We might even see the effigy come down this turn. Yeah, there we go. So even if the Ragnaros kills the Azure Drake, you get another five drop. And if it doesn't, well, you can then use the spell power to start helping deal with the Ragnaros.
Okay, that Drake into the Nourish is actually potentially even more important than you might think, because remember, Jason didn't know what that secret was that was being played. He only had the Malagos available to him to play. For all he knew, that was Mirror Entity. So he picked up a minion
and
that was playable.
Guard.
But Pavel hits the Doom Guard off the effigy. This game is swinging back and forth so quickly.
Yeah, I'm ready for the second Doomguard off the Firelands Portal at this rate.
I mean, Sorcerer's Apprentice comes down. That gives him a little bit more flexibility in terms of his mana usage here. He's able to play the Firelands Portal and the Frostbolt. I mean, that's a lot of stats for sure, the 6-6 against Druid, but it is Pavel's job in this situation to be the aggressor.
Yeah, he's He's definitely going to be able to use a lot of pressure here just because the minion's very difficult to deal with. And at the moment, Jason has quite a lot of health anyway, so the death rattle from the 6-6 isn't really going to do too much. Just going to help it on the board presence overall.
Yep, so Jason Joe looking at his hand here. Now that the secret has been cleared, he is free to develop that Malagos if he wants to try and combine it with the Moonfire and take care of the 6-6 or the 5-3 on the board. And may want to try and get full value out of the 6-6's healing a bit later on. But for now, at least, yeah, the Moonfire is going to come down. He is just going to choose to take the maximum stats off the board, picks up his healing, and now with a Malagos in play, he's in a very comfortable position.
Yeah, definitely looking pretty good. The Malagos surviving onto the board is a big deal. It's just going to be if Jason can survive and, you know, really cash in. As he said, he's got the Wrath, but the Nourish into more removal, the Moonfires, is what's going to be really important, just to really beat down what Pavel has left.
Yeah, so, I mean, the Malagos on the board is such a huge deal for Jason right now. It demands an answer. Blood Mage gonna come down. He might even just be trying to cycle here, boy. He's just gonna load up minions against it, use the Flame Strike to try and take care of the Malagos.
Yeah, I think he pretty much has to, actually. Like this, you know, as you said, you just can't leave it up. If the Malagos survives, even like a single swipe is going to be a really big deal.
Yeah, he hasn't seen any swipes. But I know he did see one swipe used early in combination with the Mulch and the Innovate turn, which means that Jason, he was just forced to play around it. I mean, the swipe would be an absolute blowout in that situation.
Yeah, the Raven Idol is looking pretty good so far. He has another Nourish as well, as an option, as well as a Mulch. Can't quite see the other one, though.
Yeah, the Nourish being picked up is huge. Now the Arcane Giants in his hand enable him to just keep putting down pressure on the board. He spent the vast majority of this game just casting spells, so this is an absolutely huge outcome for him.
Yeah, just being able to slam two Arcane Giants down, like, what is Pavel even going to do at this point? Just a Flame Waker available for him. Blood Mage is going to draw into the Drake, which will definitely help out. But, you know, what can he do? He's not putting enough pressure on Jason. Jason's still at 30 health, and that is going to be the concede. Jason Zhou goes 2-0 up, and Pavel just was not enough there. Even with the huge hand advantage, it just wasn't enough. The huge turn with the Malagos, dropping those giants, ending up that game pretty quickly.
Yeah, and we saw, you know, the opening hand had so much mana acceleration in it from Jason that he just needed to start picking up those huge threats to be able to use that mana advantage. Got the Rag, got the Malagos, the Arcane Giant into Nourish turn was huge, and then the Arcane Giants just finished the job.
Yep, Jason Joe, 2-1 up versus Pavel. Gonna find out how this series continues straight after this.
Hearthstone World Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
Have you started thinking about playing on the big BlizzCon stage yet?
I did think about it, but I need to be like come out through the group stage first.
Have you thought about the money at all?
Yeah, it's a lot of money, right? I maybe spend some money to travel a bit and rest, and maybe to do some investment.
Investing into Hearthstone packs, perhaps?
Actually, I always do that.
A Control Warrior is always expensive, right?
Yeah, it's always expensive.
Who's been the coolest person that you've met in all of your travels?
My fans, my stream.
Oh, your fans. You have to pick one person, though. Does he have blue hair?
Okay, you are the coolest person. We can make a deal. If I win the musical champion title, I can make the blue hair. Yeah.
Deal?
Just like you.
Just like me, Mohawk too?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, just like you.
Deal.
Gadgetzan, the city of opportunity.
Gadgetzan, where the gangs rule the streets. Gadgetzan, full of swindlers and cheats. Set on sale, the ring-a-ding-ding on the mean streets of Gadgetzan. Gadgetzan, where crime doesn't pay. Gadgetzan, but we do it anyway. Take on your rivals for your gang survival and the turf that belongs to your clan.
Every little kid, everybody's crooked.
Welcome to the big time, pal!
On the main streets of Gadgetzan.
Now who's got the upper hand?
Your strategy with your decks coming into the World Championship?
I just bring decks which is, in my opinion, the best. I mean, all my decks is good against Control Warrior, maybe except Druid, but Druid also have decent chance against it. And all my decks in general very strong.
So how do you think you compare to the other players at the World Championship?
I don't think that anyone have better chance to win BlizzCon than me. Someone players have less chance than me, I think, and someone have equal chance.
Do you think winning BlizzCon will change your life?
Yeah, it will definitely change my life. I mean, I will get a lot of money, more popularity.
You were very close to qualifying for the World Championship last year.
Yep.
How did it feel this year after you won the last call and qualified?
Yeah, I'm super glad that I qualified for BlizzCon and that I'm here. Hopefully, I will win BlizzCon.
Mm-hmm.
And we are back with Pavel versus Jason Joe. Jason Joe is 2-1 up at the moment. Sorry about that slight delay, but we should be ready to get into the next game. Pavel, can he do it, Sol?
Of course he can. He's been in this situation multiple times already. He's faced more adversity than this, coming back from 0-3 down on two different occasions. So this small deficit will be water off a duck's back to him. He is the Russian comeback kid.
Yeah, just a walk in the park. But Jason Joe is no pushover himself. He's looking great so far in this series. As we do get into the next game, it's going to be Jason Joe on the Dragon Warrior that we saw him lose with earlier versus right. Pavel's Tempo Mage again. How does this matchup normally go, Sol?
I mean, one of the reasons why Tempo Mage originally came back to popularity is that it started to pick up decent win rate against Dragon Warrior at the point where Dragon Warrior was absolutely terrorizing the meta. So you'd have to think it does reasonably well still, but this opening hand from Pavel is looking dry and the exact opposite for Jason. He has the absolute dream available.
There is a slight difference between the opening hands here, just a little bit. The double War Axe into three drops as well just means Jason Joe can do pretty much anything he wants right about now. And even the Alex Strasser's champion coming down, being able to get that easy trade on the Thanos.
Yeah, as if he needed the help, already had both War Axes available to him. Picked up the Alex Strasser's champion, which is actually even a better tempo tool than the War Axes that he already had. And the missiles!
Why not?
Take care of it though, but Jason is just fine with that. Honestly, he has the War Axes to start ramping back.
Yeah, and he even has the three drops just to follow up as well. He can do pretty much what he wants here, but the War Axe does look like the best play. He can work his way into the Twilight Guardian next turn. Is having that Deathwing available as well means that, you know, normally having a 10 drop in your hand is not great this early on, but he will have a dragon synergy buff all of the time. The Twilight Guardian, the Blackwing Corruptors, another Alex Strasser's champion, they are just going to be live and active.
I mean, I'd be really surprised to see any play that isn't the War Axe here, even though it's off curve, even though it does, you know, it's mana inefficient, doesn't use his resources as efficiently. This is Tempo Mage you're playing against, and the way that Tempo Mage beats you is pushing through early damage with these snowball minions that they have, and then backing that up with burn and late-game minions later on.
This is not what Pavel wanted to draw. He does not have those minions to play this turn. He can do nothing. Pink, pass on four, Jason Joe, quick nod, and that must be a huge confidence booster for him in this game.
Right, so imagine the difference here from Jason's perspective. If he's putting a fireball as one of the cards in his opponent's hand because he knows it's running dry right now. If he'd have coined this out on the last turn or just played one of his three drops into the mana worm, the fireball comes down. Pavel has counterplay. He pushes through. So instead, just equipping the fiery War Axe and starting to take care of the minions one by one, he's made the tempo plays from Pavel basically non-existent. He has no answer to this.
Yeah, and one of the card choices we were talking about earlier in this Dragon Warrior is the single slam. And wow, that got value, helped cycle for Jason, and most importantly, with the addition of the second swing of that Fiery War Axe, helped clear up that Azure Drake and presented a very, very scary board for Pavel to look at this turn, as he is still one turn away from that Flame Strike.
Yeah, he really is, and still no perfect answer to this board state. I think he's just going to try and recreate board tension with the Faceless Summoner, but Jason...
A good one!
That is certainly a little bit of tension, but Jason has so much game against these attempted pushes onto the board with minions. Just look at this potential Blackwing Corruptor plus Fiery War Axe turn to just continue to trade through and dominate the board. He's in such good shape here.
Yeah, he's playing on a hell of a lot of pressure, and even worst case scenario, we go to the late game, Deathwing has just been chilling in the hand for a while, he can just end it as well. His mage does not have a great answer, unless Pavel's gonna pull another polymorph out of that babbling bug.
I mean, and this is what makes the line that Jason took so much more appealing as well, is that he kind of just has the late game locked up.
Yeah.
He had no reason to try and rush against the Mana Worm, equip the Fiery War Axe, played it slow, and again, every interaction that's come since then has been dependent on that decision to play off curve early on and equip that War Axe with three mana available.
Yeah, definitely one of the key decisions that's helped him get ahead here. Pavel is going to try to mount a defense, though. Not going to just go for the Flame Strike this turn. Going to take down the Frothing Berserker and set up a bit of a scary board himself.
Yeah, I do wonder about this decision from Jason to be aggressive on the previous turn, because as I said, with the Deathwing in hand, it really does feel like the late game is locked up in his favor. Tempo Mage just has no game against a 12-12 on the board, apart from that unique out that you already talked about. But I guess Jason's read is that he's putting his opponent now on things like Flamestrike, like Firelands Portal, like Ragnaros even, potential cards that are in hand. And he's looking and saying, okay, if I give my opponent the chance to come back into this game, his expensive cards that he clearly has in hand can have a big impact.
Yeah, and we see now Jason choosing to actually try and trade up and slow this game down a little bit because of that. We can see Pavel is putting together a good amount of damage. Did use the
Get it.
He did use the portal to clear up the first Corruptor. Arcane missiles for the next, but he does have a fireball in hand, even with the Drake to help cycle into even more burn. And the 6-5 from the Violence Portal is a huge threat in itself at the moment.
Yeah, Jason Joe going to start off his turn here with the Finley. The rest of his turn was only 7 mana available, so he may as well lead out with the Finley, see if it changes his mind. But there's not a hero power that's really going to bail him out of trouble this turn. It's about how he sees his game plan. Steady Shot can potentially get him into immediate range so that when Deathwing comes down, Deathwing plus the hero power the next turn will threaten lethal if he can just find a way to press it a couple of turns over the next turn or two. But does he feel like he's trying to set up an aggressive win, or is he favoring a more stabilizing hero power like the Lesser Heal?
It's definitely a tough call to make. He's gone with the Lesser Heal. He might have even been looking for the Mage hero power to trade Corcoran into the 6-5 and ping it down, which just removes the threat from the board, as opposed to this play, which just says, okay, I'm just gonna play 2 taunts. You're just probably not going to be able to hit through both as well as punch me in the face for 6. Arcane Blast is going to help, though. He did exactly what I said he couldn't. And that 6 to face is going to change everything with that Azure Drake and a Fireball in hand.
The clock right now is so real for Pavel. He's sitting on the Fireball. The Curator pickup is huge. That keeps him alive. And now this is potentially the one turn that he needed to get himself the Deathwing in play and start to put the pressure back onto Pavel.
Yeah, the problem is he needs to do that little bit of extra damage. Deathwing coming down clears the board, great. But Pavel, especially with this Arcane Intellect, has access to more burn. And if he can just kill him the turn Deathwing's played, who cares at this moment? He's going for it.
Yep, I love this. He realizes.
Leroy! That is the game!
Leroy!
Firelands Paul and Pavel with the smile. Leroy Jenkins, let's not wait for Deathwing. Let's end the game now.
Pavel is a literal god. Pavel is just manipulating reality to his will this tournament. Serious note, he had the Fireball to back it up the next turn. Deathwing was almost certainly going to come down. The Fireball would have ended the game either way, but he wanted to go out in style, gets the Leroy Jenkins to push through. Pavel right back in this series.
Yeah, absolutely insane series so far, and we are going to be right back with the next match of Pavel versus Jason Joe. We are back, everyone. I think everyone needed just a minute to recover from the end of that specific game. Firelands Paul into Leroy to end it from Pavel. Accompanied by the nice smile over the monitor at Jason, you can't really argue with that, but these plays are even now. It is 2-2, and this is a best of seven, of course. Two more decks for each player to win with, and hey, both Rogue and Warrior.
Yeah, but still dramatic differences in the two decks. Of course, Pavel as the greedy Malagos rogue. Jason has somewhat of a unique rogue where it resembles the questing build that people have been playing recently, but it's cut the questings out. It's kind of all the way back to an old school miracle rogue where it's just Leroy Coldblood as a win condition. Two conceals in there as well to try and make board pushes. But you know, Pavel as well sitting on the C'Thun warrior of his own, whereas Jason has got himself away from those control warrior strategies and moved to the Dragon Warrior.
Yeah, and the lack of questing is it's going to make this matchup a little bit more strange than normal. This sort of, it acts similar to the questing versus Malagos matchup, but Jason can't be as aggressive as you can with Quest Adventurers because, he just doesn't have he needs to buy the time and really push for the late game win condition as opposed to just slamming a questing, get concealed, build it up, and pressure with Cold Bloods. That's just not an option. So there's potential that Pavel is just going to join him in the very late game and just kill him with Mally.
Pavel just swashes into an Assassin's Blade as well. That's potentially really big. It just represents 12 damage. Rogue these days, Kyle, all the healing. So if you can get them on a clock, one of their weaknesses is decks that are able to push fast, repetitive damage. And Assassin's Blade is a card that allows Rogue to do just that. So Pavel can grab himself a board here. He might be able to just leverage that Assassin's Blade and be able to skip the whole Malagos proceedings entirely.
Yeah, that's actually pretty huge. It kind of...
What just happened?
Oh.
Jason just played an Edwin on the board and then followed it up with a backstab. That is just pure missequencing. Wanted to have the 4-4 on the board. Instead, he's just sat with a miserable 2-2 and one of his biggest resources is gone. That is a potentially huge error for Jason.
Yeah, that is massive. And you saw straight away, as soon as that Van Cleef hit the board, Jason just looked down to the desk and was like, what did I just do? Yep. Because that, as you said, could be game changing. And the amount of pressure these players are under, that there's always going to be moments where it gets very difficult and you just slip once. And that could be one of these moments.
Yeah, two words. Slow down. He played that turn within the first 5 seconds of his turn timer. Why? Why are you doing that? You have 75 seconds available to you to think through everything, to make sure tiny little mechanical errors like that don't happen. I've been bringing this point up over and over again towards Pavel during this tournament proceedings. This time it's Jason falling foul of it. This is one of the most important games of Hearthstone in your life. Do you not have the time to just sit and
just snap play every turn. Pavel did take his time though, the rope started burning, and again, look at this turn, he's just disrespecting the Van Cleef, just gonna whack him in the face with that Assassin's Blade, and there is no counterplay in terms of weapon destruction in Jason Joe's Rogue, so there's not a lot he can really do about it.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting actually, because Jason has favored the Harrison in a number of his other decks. He has it in the Druid, he has it in the Shaman, but choosing not to go with it in the Rogue here, it is a little bit clunky. Rogue, a very streamlined deck. It just wants to do what it wants to do. And, I illuminated this possibility early on, which is just Pavel grabbing tempo and then leveraging this Assassin's Blade with just the burst damage that he has on the left-hand side of his hand to be able to end this game essentially in the fashion of just old school aggro Rogue. Basically, that's a deck that used to play Sinister Strike just as one mana, three damage, get it done. And that's exactly what this strategy right now is resembling from Pavel. And so key to this, Pavel needed to grab tempo to be able to leverage this Assassin's Blade. A 2-2 on the board and a 4-4 on the board. That's a huge difference.
Yeah, that is huge. And as you said, Pavel's very quickly getting to the point where he can just kill Jason Joe. Second as Yordrake is going to help out as well, but it might just be Sinister Strike with Abyss to clear up the opponent's as Yordrake. Never mind.
No
reason
to.
He just wants to play Abyss.
Yep.
Sorry, Abyss, Sinister Strike, and hit with the dagger to finish this game. And It's got to be said that Van Cleef being a 4-4 would have changed the outlook of this match.
Yep, there is actually no reason to interact with this Azir Drake on that turn. You're just not going to die to a 7-mana hand with a Drake in play. So next turn, by playing the Emperor, even if by some miracle he can't get physical damage through, Drake, Avis, Sinister Strike is just lethal from hand anyway. So this is pretty much going to lock up this game from Pavel, and Jason is going to be cursing that huge error early on that could have potentially cost him this game, potentially cost him this series, potentially cost him a world championship.
Absolutely huge. And Pavel has just cashed in and identified his game plan very quickly. That Assassin's Blade unlocked a completely new route for the deck. And he's executed it really well, going for the Emperor there. Like, as you said, no real reason to interact with the Azure Drake. And that is going to be game two, Pavel. And he's going to go 3-2 versus Jason Joe. One more game from qualifying for the Hearthstone World Championship Finals.
Yeah, Pavel plays out the hand, shows his strategy, says, hey, this Emperor was a setup all along, but as you mentioned, that Assassin's Blade allowed him to create that strategy of just playing old school tempo rogue, old school aggro rogue, just push damage, grab the board, push damage, and Jason had that one turn where he could have grabbed the board with the 4-4 Van Cleef. Horrible missequencing error, and it could be just so costly for him now.
Yeah, you know, Pavel is one game away from potentially booking his spot in the finals. So we'll be back very soon with that game. Do not go anywhere.
The Hearthstone World Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
Pavel is 3-2 up versus Jason Joe in the first semi-final of the day. One game away for him to qualify for the finals. Jason Joe, though, does have a chance at coming back. He made a huge error in the previous game, but he still has a chance.
And this guy is an incredible player. That error that he made is the kind of error that has no reflection on your ability as a Hearthstone player. You know, as long as you've played Hearthstone to a basic level, you understand the order that you're supposed to play Backstab and SI7 and Edwin Van Cleef in. It's not something that you just mess up because you're thinking about the game, that you don't understand what's going on. That is just purely a misclick, just a mechanical error. A mechanical error with execution, but now Jason is in the spot where he can turn this into an opportunity to get back to his old form, but Pavel is right on the line of grand finals.
Yeah, he is one game away, and we are in that game right now. Pavel's C'Thun Warrior versus Jason Zhou's Rogue. He does have Van Cleef in his opening hand.
He does, and it's going to be hard for him to push through here because, as we mentioned, this is a deck that's cut out a couple of win conditions, potential win conditions against Warrior. The questings are huge threats that need to be answered. This is a pure Leroy Coldblood as the win condition form of Rogue, which is, you know, can have trouble just getting damage through against C'Thun Warrior a lot of the time. Does still play double conceal, though, which is another thing that Warrior does really struggle to interact with.
Speaking of double conceal, There it is in the hand. But yeah, you know, we even saw on that last turn from Jason Joe in the previous game, the double cold blood, and it's just 12 damage out of nowhere. So it can be difficult to deal with, and he still has the ability to stack up that damage. But for now, Pavel is feeling pretty comfortable being able to follow up with that fiery war axe. Acolyte's still on the board and still needs to be answered. And Rogue kind of doesn't really answer Acolyte very well outside of a Azure Drake backstab.
Oh, I was just about to say, Pavel's hand right now is set up so perfectly to deal with a Tomb Pillager, but almost luckily for Jason Joe, he didn't have it, but then he drew the Tomb Pillager, and now the Ravaging Ghoul play is going to punish it. The War Axe comes down, takes care of it, and he cycles a card off the Acolyte here. Pavel is just watching his dreams come true at this moment.
Yeah, Jason Joe does have access to a reasonable turn now, though. He can set up the Gadgetzan with coin, Gadgetzan coin conceal, but he is going to go with the clear and just start to reduce this board size down. The SI is going to challenge the ghoul, starting to hold off on the Gadgetzan turn this time.
This is interesting too as well, because he had the opportunity to just conceal this board and make a push for damage. He could have played the second coin as well, then the Edwin to max out the size of it, and then concealed and had this huge board presence that he could have pushed through, potentially checking for a brawl. And then if the brawl happens, you have Gadgetzan conceal to follow that up on a later turn, but decided to just go for the minion presence here, keep both of those conceals available to him, potentially to pair with those cold bloods later on.
Yeah, Pavel has a great turn here. The sheer power of Bran in the C'Thun deck is huge. One, it helped him just kill Van Cleef with the double disciple hits. And oh, by the way, the double disciple hits buff C'Thun twice, which means this shield bearer on curve is going to work out for him. Also means the C'Thun's just generally getting bigger, which is now in his hands. So a very real consideration for just killing your opponent with it. A lot of the time, you buff up C'Thun and it doesn't end up in your hand until really late in the game. But now Pavel can just play as if he can just kill his opponent.
Yeah, and Rogue as a class just doesn't really have outs to C'Thun. If C'Thun hits the board and clears, right, it's probably the worst minion in the game to sap back to your opponent's hand, as long as they didn't innovate it out or some nonsense in Druid. And Pavel, it just seems destined. He would have woke up this morning, and he would have just been praying that one, he can play to his potential, but two, he just had that little bit of luck working on his side. And right now, it seems like both of those things are coming together in the perfect synergy for Pavel.
Yeah, Pavel is in a great spot, and it's only getting better because Shield Bearer on curve with the armor is a good play. Equipping Gore Halkill on a minion, prepping it for next turn is a good play. But you really want to play the Shield Bearer combined with the Shield Slam, which is 8 mana. And you know what? Twin Amps on 7 is always a good play. And he drew into it, and he's causing Jason Joe some headaches now.
All right, so now this is Jason's push. He has this concealed board. If he can get one minion to stick here, as could be the case with this Auctioneer, now he has the Cold Blood to follow up and the Reconceal just to try and get the 1-2 punch, forcing the Cold Blood damage through twice. So this is a potentially huge decision for Pavel. He can choose to take the Brawl 50-50 here and try and deny the Auctioneer, or he can just try and load up on pressure and move towards the win condition himself, as you said, stated, of just ending the game with C'Thun.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think he needs to risk the brawl at all, to be honest. He has Shield Bearer this turn. He can even follow up with Gore Howl into C'Thun if he really needs to just really push the damage.
Yep.
Because realistically, Jason's just not going to pile the board wide with minions. The Rogue just doesn't really have the ability to do that, especially with no questing. So, you know, even one additional minion comes out, well, C'Thun at worst is going to clear the board. Mm-hmm. And then what does he do?
Yeah, I mean, I really like Doomcaller this turn. Just huge threat in play, threatening lethal. That keeps the Shield Bearer Shield Slam combination available to you if you need to be able to take care of a minion. And there's no way this game is progressing to the point where you need Doomcaller to revive C'Thun.
No.
That's just not happening. So let's get the 7-9 down in play. Let's buff C'Thun up even higher. He actually chooses to go for the C'Thun's chosen here instead, which is a little bit interesting to me. This is just less power in play. It allows him to fit in the armor up as well if he's really worried about just dying straight up this turn.
Yeah, I think there's just on 26, there's just like probably a small just a small niggle in Pavel's mind that he's like, well, there is a gadget Zen down. There's already a lot of cards in my opponent's hand. If the stars align, it goes into sap, cold blood, you know, it starts just stacking up that much damage. There's a chance I just die, and then Shield Bearer with the 10 armor isn't enough to stabilize next turn. So I don't mind this play, although Doomcaller felt like the standard go-to. I do completely understand this play from Pavel, just playing it safe, because as you said, the game is not going to go long, and so far it seems to be favoring Pavel here.
Yeah, Jason does go ahead and use the sap. He's picked up the Leeroy now, so his damage potential is huge in this position, and this is exactly what I talked about. Push the damage, try and get two swings out of your Cold Blood, and look, doesn't even play the Swashbuckler to play around the potential Brawl from Pavel. And here's another factor of playing C'Thun's Chosen on the previous turn as opposed to playing a bigger minion. This turn, he would have C'Thun's Chosen Brawl available to him. That would give him another option of potentially being able to deal with the Auctioneer.
Yeah, it really would, actually. That would have been a tough one for Jason Cho to react to if the Auctioneer did die to the Brawl, but look at this hand. This hand just may as well say, draw your deck because of the Gadget Zen on the board. Gonna see the Azure Drake come down first, though. Not gonna start off with a prep. It's two Eviscerates available, but even more damage. This is looking pretty scary for Pavel now.
Yep, still a Cold Blood left in the deck as well, I believe, on top of those two Eviscerates, but he's already used too much mana this turn to be able to force through Leeroy. So that is 10 damage from Eviscerates plus 12 from the Gadgetzan Auctioneer, making 22, but he is just gonna send it all downtown right now if he pushes the second Cold Blood in as well.
Yeah, Pavel's going to be no doubt tracking these cards, needs to know what is available. And now he can't really play C'Thun, because even if it clears the board, there's only, what, one card left in Jason's deck? Like, Leeroy into Cold Blood plus weapon kills him if he doesn't armor up whilst playing C'Thun.
So this is now purely a survival game from Pavel's perspective. He knows the entire deck is in the hand, and he knows what those cards are. So all he needs to do is be able to beat minion presence and the small amount of remaining damage, which is Leeroy and Cold Blood in terms of damage from hand. So this is the play I like.
Yeah.
Brawl the board. Whichever minion lives, you have the Shield Slam to then take care of it. You're at 16 life. You cannot die based on your opponent's deck.
Yeah, and you don't, you know, Gorhal might have been an attractive option to get it equipped, but you do not want to take the damage. Because as you said, all Pavel needs to do is to survive. This rogue will run out of burn, and the game will be Pavel's if he can outlast Jason Zhou. And he does have a reasonable way to do it, as long as he can fend off these minions and guarantee the out of range.
Ooh. Whoa! Oh boy, that's damage. That is damage that Pavel cannot have been accounting for. With the Drake in hand still, the Alexstrasza champion can come down and push another three. That is such a big deal for Jason Zhou right now.
Yeah, Swashbuckler is just causing havoc in this series so far. Sparring partner looks like it's going to be a consideration for Jason Zhou over the dagger up, just to make the board as awkward as possible. But going wide on the board means that second Brawl is going to be looking pretty tasty right about now.
It picks up the execute, but no way to activate it in terms of being able to clear up the last minion that would survive a brawl. So the amount of health on the board as well, let's take a look at that. There is 6, 9, 11 health on the board, and he does have C'Thun available to him at, I believe, 12-12. So that seems a little bit ambitious in terms of the counterpunch. There it is, the 12-12 C'Thun. So I think it's going to have to be a brawl, but brawl armor up here takes him up to 15. He knows that there is 11 damage available from hand. Leeroy plus Cold Blood plus the dagger. So if he is at 15 and the Tomb Pillager lives, he dies.
Yep. You have to take that chance, I think, though. There is just too much damage on the board to just pass, I believe.
So what about the 4-6 taunt? That is just the Veclanash, right? That is just the single 4-6 taunt that won't regenerate. So if he put that into play, he saw the second sap get burned, which means that Jason Zhou would have to go through that the hard way.
There
but it does
brawl,
end up being the brawl. If Tomb Pillager lives, this game is over. Okay. Pavel lives to fight another day.
Jason Zhou has his work cut out for him now. He still has the Alexstrasza champion, so the brawl wasn't a complete disaster for him. If a Swashbuckler lived, then that is a horrible just as a 1-1. Not going to push through the damage needed at all.
Yeah, so magically as well right now, he is at 12, so Jason Joe needs to push one this turn to make sure he's playing around C'Thun, because if he pushes the one, he puts his opponent to 11, which means if his opponent plays C'Thun, he then has Leroy Coldblood's second dagger hit to deal that 11 damage. So I actually feel like the dagger hit would be pretty important in this situation, but Jason has probably decided he cannot beat C'Thun this game and just isn't considering it in his options.
Yeah, and it looks like... C'Thun kind of has to be the option here. Everything else just isn't good enough because Pavel knows exactly what Jason Joe's win condition is going to be.
He's checking the minions. That's a full clear. And what did I say? He is one damage out of range right now. Leroy Coldblood is 10.
He can do.
Dagger is 11. He has no game against this C'Thun. Jason Joe, China's last hope, looks like he's going down here. And it is the Russian comeback kid. Is going to be our first finalist at the 2016 World Championship.
Absolutely amazing series, some incredible moments. I can't not believe it. Pavel has made it to the finals. He has probably had one of the roughest sets of games to get here, having to do multiple comebacks, but he must be pretty happy now booking that spot in the grand finals here at BlizzCon. You can check out his road to that finals. First off, that insane match versus Amnesiac was completely bonkers. And then he just seen him beat down Jason Zhou in another crazy series. But he is ready to give his thoughts on what it feels like to be in the grand finals with Frodan on the stage.
Pavel, you've done it again, and now you're in the finals. I'm seeing you getting some pretty amazing things from Firelands Portal. What's your secret? How are you doing that?
I get Leroy from Firelands Portal, but actually it was doesn't matter because I anyway had Fireball in my hand, and nothing could have saved him.
Nothing could have saved him from the onslaught of Pavel. You're the first player from Russia to go and represent the World Championship in the Grand Final. What does that mean to you?
I really happy that I represent Russia and have really nice results. It'll be nice if final gonna be me against Dr. Hippie. Even more nicer if I will win this final.
All right, he wants to face Dr. Hippie in the grand finals, so he wants to see another fellow European in the grand finals. Thank you so much. Congratulations, Pavel is your first finalist for the World Championship of 2016.